people who understand your needs and are committed to helping you make it happen. At DKP & Co Chartered Accountants, we are more than just accountants. We are business advisors, taxation consultants, and strategists that specialized in setting up businesses. We understand the client and give them the very best customized advice and strategies to achieve their goals. Visit our website, dkpco.com.au, or give us a call today on 03 9023 9370. Fast, proactive, personal. That's DKP & Co Chartered Accountants.
Since 1998, Lanco Group has been providing superior civil engineering solutions and advice to developers, local government, and service authorities across Australia. Lanco Group is known for delivering sustainable, efficient solutions. By working closely with clients, Lanco Group is able to meet the complex infrastructure requirements for residential, commercial, and industrial developments on time, on budget. Find out more at lancogroup.com.au. Lanco Group, your business partner for engineering solutions.
Buying your electricity from the big energy companies is now the most expensive way to power your home. In fact, the average electricity bill in Australia has more than doubled in the last 15 years, but not for the ones who went solar. Unlike your electricity bill, the price of solar has actually come down, and there's also government rebates available. So what are you waiting for? Join the 2 million households already saving hundreds of dollars every year. See how much your roof could be making you at solarpowerco.com.au. Go solar and get $500 cash back with the Solar Power Co, Australia's most trusted solar brand. solarpowerco.com.au.
Are you looking to change your destiny in life? Be your own boss? Start your own business? If you are, you need people who understand your needs and are committed to helping you make it happen. At DKP & Co Chartered Accountants, we are more than just accountants. We are business advisors, taxation consultants, and strategists that specialized in setting up businesses. We understand the client and give them the very best customized advice and strategies to achieve their goals. Visit our website, dkpco.com.au, or give us a call today on 03 9023 9370. Fast, proactive, personal. That's DKP & Co Chartered Accountants.
Since 1998, Lanco Group has been providing superior civil engineering solutions and advice to developers, local government, and service authorities across Australia. Lanco Group is known for delivering sustainable, efficient solutions. By working closely with clients, Lanco Group is able to meet the complex infrastructure requirements for residential, commercial, and industrial developments on time, on budget. Find out more at lancogroup.com.au. Lanco Group, your business partner for engineering solutions.
Welcome to If You Know Your History on FNR Football Nation Radio. My name is Paul Mavridis, and I am joined by a very special guest initially, and an even more special guest afterwards, but we'll deal with that later. Andy Paschalidis, who's here to talk about the passing of one of his friends and one of the legends of Australian soccer journalism, John Economos. Andy, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me on board.
Now, you're on the side of the road, so we'll just, people listening into this, you know, just it's all good, he's safe. We've also we've had a previous guest on the side of a road as well, so this is not new to us.
It's unfortunate in a way that I've got to do it this way, but I'm on the way to do my nightly duties with my 92-year-old dad. Who brought me into the game all those years ago when I was nine. I had that choice of going to Greek school or football. Incredible, my dad left me with that choice because football training was in the same nights as Greek school. And, you know, over the years I've said to him, Dad, if you didn't let me do that, the journey I've taken would not have happened. Wow. So I didn't go to uni like all the rest of the family. I was the black sheep. But, you know, and that journey, it kicked off for me in the media in 83, 84 at Australian Soccer Weekly. And this is before the internet and everything else. Your staple diet was Soccer Action, Soccer Weekly. Once a week, you'd all rush to the news agent on a Tuesday morning and nine times out of 10, John Scoop Economos would have the front page, but he had a subtle way of getting that front page. He'd come in when we pretty much laid out the front page on a Monday arvo and said, guys, stop the presses. I've got a scoop. So, yeah, and he had a nickname for everyone and just a larger-than-life character who, amazing detail, amazing memory. He could remember games, dates, scorers, lineups, and it was like that with a lot of things, not just football. He was a cricket tragic, loved politics. He could tell you all the lines out of every Godfather movie. So if you sat down with him, you'd probably have to spend a day just going through that. But you know what? He used to, you look forward to seeing him coming into the press box. And he was very close at St. George, obviously. That's where his bestie, Johnny Wine, they went to Cleveland Boys High School, not far from where I'm parked, actually. And, yeah, he served numerous roles with St. George, but he loved going to Marconi as a nickname at the Palace. And Appiah Leichhardt, he had a very strong relationship with Tony Rossini, who's one of the longest administrators in football when you look at that. I think it's close to three decades for Tony at Appiah Leichhardt. But, yeah, it was a sudden passing. We haven't heard the autopsy report, but I'm led to believe it was a heart attack. Alone at home, one relative here, relatives back in Kythira, which is a beautiful island off the Peloponnese coast, which ironically, where my mother's from, Neapolis, we can see across the bay where the wonderful Kythira is. And he only engaged on that Greek side of his family tree in the last 15, 20 years. Okay. Yeah, much like a lot of us. I mean, I've only been to Greece three times and I'm 59, and I first went there after the World Cup in Germany 2006, which is a shame because, you know, you should be proud of your history, and he always was, you know, and I'm just sad because as these years go on, I'm part of that old football, like George Denikin, of course, and, you know, guys like Ray Gatt, he retired from the Australian newspaper not long ago, and John was one of two journalists to be inducted to the FA Hall of Fame. That's a fantastic achievement.
He'd been writing for such a long time. He was an editor.
Yeah.
He wrote across a number of publications, but most notably, obviously, the Greek Herald and the Australian Soccer Weekly.
Yeah.
Your tribute to him notes how well-loved he was among the biggest names in world football. But also, what was great about reading about on Twitter was just the outpouring of condolences and memories from people online from the Australian soccer community. I saw Mike Fozzie's tribute as well. I mean, that's how much impact he had.
You know, the thing with John too, and it's a rare trait, let's be honest, it's a rare trait. He would have the confidence of players and coaches, and what they would tell him a lot of times would have been a great story to break. But out of respect and courtesy for them, knowing that he wants to keep that relationship going, because you don't want to just get a story, put it on the front page, burn your bridges, and that's it. John was the reverse of that. And he'd always, you know, his stories were not, he never wrote about personal issues or issues with players or coaches or match officials or anyone in the game that might have done the wrong thing away from football. It was all about promoting the game. It was all about, you know, giving his slant. And the thing was, you know how we would do interviews, like you do interviews now on this show, it might be 10 minutes with someone. John, when he would engage with someone, I've seen it, it wouldn't be like a 10-minute conversation. He would be there three or four cups of coffee later, 2 hours later, people are going, oh, geez, time's flown, off we go. But he had that presence about him. You know, he was very infectious. There's no one that's going to say a bad word about John Economos at all. As much as he went to university and he could have forged a career at the top end of town, his passion was football. And that's why he moved away from that sort of corporate world and focused primarily on football. And there was one comment from a guy in Melbourne who used to put an ad for his pub. And he wrote the comment, what was his surname? T-R-I-N-H, I think, was his surname.
Yeah, Peter Trin.
Yeah, but he said, you know what, I didn't really follow football that much. I loved having you out in there because it got me business. Mm. Yeah, as my pub was reacting to those advertisements. So it just goes to show you, even though that paper was published out of Sydney, it was a national publication, you know, and it was a very, very important tool for us, because you've got to remember, say, if you go back to the 70s and 80s, our staple diet football-wise, pre-SBS, was the ABC match of the day on a Monday night. Yeah. That's it. Mm. That's all we had. Mm. We didn't have pretty much anything else. When I was a kid growing up as well, it was really bizarre, but I used to see Bundesliga highlights on Channel 10 on a Saturday morning before I'd go and play my grassroots football at 12, 13, 14 years of age. I'd be diving around the lounge wanting to replicate what those Germans were doing. But, yeah, there's a legacy there with John. You know, he impacted so many. His passion was second to none. Really,
and in that era, I mean, it's not that you don't have your passion now as a football writer, obviously that you still need it to do it, but it's not an easy gig. But back in those days when everything was done by hand on like antique equipment, and when you're the only people, like, you know, people like Laurie Schwab in Melbourne and, you know, people up in Sydney, it's like if you don't do it, nobody else will, and there's nowhere else to get the information from.
Well, you're right. You know, you just mentioned Laurie. Laurie, again, you know, what a great servant he was. You know, you got Laurie, Peter DeSera, Alan Crisp, Tom McCain from Adelaide. There were so many of those John Economos-like figures that were at the, you know, it was like they were at the front of the battle and we all followed them. We all came through the system and they were the leaders. You know, and you got to remember, in those times, our game was being pushed into the, you know, the dark spaces of sports pages, you know, little column, you know, story about the Socceroos playing as against a groin injury for Jezelenko on the back page. So that was a battle in itself. And guys like John were in the forefront of that battle. And what it does for people like myself and others, I think, it actually gives you confidence that what you're doing for football, don't give up on it, you know, keep pushing it. You're going to find barriers pushing forward. I found barriers. I was blessed. I went from Soccer Weekly into radio with 2GB. And John used to laugh because the first time they crossed to me, I was actually covering a Sheffield Shield final and I called the last hour. And the guy crossing to me couldn't pronounce my name. And he goes, "Oh, look, can I just call you Alphabet? Why don't you shorten your name, Andy?" And I was like, "That's my name." I mean, multicultural Australia is proud of its history and it's a rich, rich mix of people of multicultural background. But we are Australian. We're born here, but we're proud of whether we're Greek, Croatian, Serb, Italian, whatever it is. You're going to be proud of that background because that's your parents, your grandparents, and that's their history. And John was actually, I think someone asked me the other week, was he born in Greece? No, he was born during a war in Queensland, Rockhampton.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so dinky die Economos Aussie.
It's interesting. I mean, we talked a little bit before about Rossidi and Marconi and all the old school kind of scene. I was thinking about what the passing of someone like John signifies, and that's kind of, another break with that era where the environment, the way the stadiums were, the way the crowds were, the way the leagues were, that the difference, the gaps between journalists and administrators and players and fans were much closer. You know, you'd come into contact with these people walking around the grounds, and we just don't have that anymore. So when you read someone like John's work or Laurie's work, you're not just getting someone who's sitting in a press box. You're getting someone who mingled, who was known.
I've been there and done it a number of times, and with John and a few other guys, you'd cover a game at Marconi and you wouldn't get home till 10 o'clock. You'd go back to the club and evaluate the game, and presidents, coaches would want to hear his thoughts on what had just unfolded in that 90 minutes at Marconi Stadium. You know, one of the great things that John's really proud about, and a lot of people wouldn't know, when the New York Cosmos came out with Pele, they played a game not far from here at the back of the Sydney Cricket Ground. It was the old sports ground. Yeah. And John was involved in marketing that game. It was that big. the fans broke down fences because it was a sellout. I've forever been trying to find footage of that. It's got to be somewhere. I would think maybe the ABC archives. But John reported on that and said, I've never seen anything like it. It wasn't a riot per se. It was just people wanted to see the Cosmos because of Pele. And there was no way you could control the crowd. Once they broke down a fence, everyone just, and they sat on the inside of the ground as well. Security couldn't control them, but they were well behaved. There was not, you know, like, unfortunately with our game, you might have an ethnic rivalry and there's a bit of a riot, dare I say, and there's two or three people arrested and it becomes front page, second page, third page, radio, television, newspapers, online. When you get 60 or 70 arrests at a one-day cricket game, it's on page 12 over two paragraphs or three paragraphs. That's always been one of his bugbears, the way the game's been treated by the mainstream media, because there are particular groups or individuals that want to find any excuse to put us down. And you would have seen it yourself firsthand.
Sure. Yeah. Well, it's quite sad that obviously John's passed away, but we celebrate a life well lived and a life in service to the game. Can we get a bit of an update as well from yourself about the heartbeat of football work that you do and where that's at the moment?
Look, it's been an interesting year. I just got a report from Queensland, a teenager was saved. Wow. And I'm contacting the gentleman who saved him because I've been talking to Queensland before they had their big announcement last week about rolling out DFibs. We'd identified 20 clubs in the greater Brisbane area without DFibs. But what I can tell you now with my calculations, 7 players have suffered cardiac arrest this year, 5 in New South Wales. Jess Amato at the indoor centre there down at where the Grand Prix is. Is it the Ted Whitten Indoor Centre there? Is that what it's called?
Oh, I'm not sure what they call it. Well,
Jess was there and they had a DFib, but they couldn't find it.
Oh, wow.
And he was saved by an off-duty first aider, a policeman, actually. So we had 5 in New South Wales, 1 in Queensland, 1 in Melbourne. And in 5 of those 7 incidents, the defibrillator was used with CPR to save them. And that's all I want. I want every club to have this life-saving device. I've gone to federal parliament. I got knocked back. I got told it's a state-by-state issue. But look at John Aaron, what he did. He was the first politician. He rolled out $3.8 million in defibs, and New South Wales followed fairly quickly. The new deputy premier, Stuart Ayres. So I'm part of that whole group with Greg Page from the Wiggles and a few other individuals. So all we want, you know, and all the football family or the greater sporting public want, when your husband, your brother, your sister, your mother, your auntie, your uncle goes to a game on a Saturday or Sunday, all we expect him, have a great day, but we want to see them come home.
A couple of weeks ago on the show, we actually did a whole episode on deaths on the football field, on the Australian football field. And, you know, when you go back to the early part of the 20th century and you see the newspaper reports, it's things like, you know, tetanus or other things that for now we take for granted. You know, it's easy to sort out. But as you move on through the 1960s, you see stories of player collapsed. And it's not hard to find those stories, and it's really tragic. And knowing that we have the tools at our disposal to try and avoid those situations it makes it feel like it's imperative to get it done.
It has to be. It should be mandatory. There should be, you know, the governing bodies have got to do more in this space. I've got to be honest. I think they can do more. What I've been doing with Heartbeat of Football, creating this amazing awareness. Football Federation Victoria, you know, Kim On and Anthony are very supportive of what we're doing. We're looking at going national next year. It's sort of been held back because of the COVID. We're looking at getting some funding. We don't have government funding, but what I can tell you with our testing this year up until, and we do it with Victor Chang. So we'd take your blood sample, we tell you your cholesterol and your blood sugar levels, and we take your blood pressure as well.
Yeah.
We found 38% of people tested this year were advised to go to their GP for further checkups. That's up from 25%. So all this inactivity, when all these players go back next year, particularly the senior players, wouldn't it be great if over 35 players to play before they could register have to show us that they've been to their GP?
Well, that's the thing, Andy. I mean, we thought about the problem that soccer has, particularly as a unique quality, is it's going to have a lot more older players than the other football codes.
Absolutely.
It's just the nature of the game.
That's where the numbers are. You know, when I started from 2014 to 16, there was 15 deaths and 3 saves. From 2016 to 19, there were 3 deaths and 15 saves. Mm. Now, late last year, we had 3 deaths. This year, we've had 7 incidents. All have been saved. Mm. That's a stunning turnaround, but there is a fear factor. Talking to the Heart Foundation and Victor Chang Cardiac Research Institute, the fear factor is the effect of COVID on footballers as well, and anyone with any heart-related issues. When you hear about people passing because of related issues, you know, underlying issues, but a lot of it's lung or heart.
Yeah.
If COVID gets you and you've got issues there, you're in big trouble. Mm. So there's a lot to do in the education and the awareness. Our real mantra next year will be testing, education, awareness, and keep chipping away. We're blessed. We've got people like Tim Kale. I noticed that John Aloisi is an ambassador for the Heart Foundation, which is brilliant. A lot of people wouldn't know. We've had Socceroos have had heart surgery. Mm. Mark Kouzis, Chris Galantzis, John Aloisi. I mean, heart disease is the biggest killer. It's the biggest killer. And unfortunately, the younger ones that we lose in most instances, like look at Kiki Numov, he had to quit after signing in Spain, after leaving Sydney FC. He had cardiomyopathy, which is a genetic issue that you don't know until it's too late in many cases. So then all the siblings get checked. It's a difficult journey, but you know, like for me, I lost a mate of mine on the field next to me. That triggered me. I'd lost another mate that was playing with Peter Catholic's team and Terry Patalis, two ex-Sydney Olympic players. John Ennis, I played with him again, a kilometre away. I played with him representative football. He died in front of his father and friends. They were trying to bring him back and his father was on the field. They put a chair there for his father and he was screaming to the clouds in Greek, "God, take me. Don't take my son." He was shrieking that for 5 some minutes. And, you know, I talked to widows. I talked to families that have lost loved ones. You know, one guy thought he had heartburn for 4 weeks. He was getting Alka-Seltzer. It was the onset of a heart attack coming, and they lost him. So there's lots to do in the education awareness in this space. I'm glad that, you know, the A-League, every club has a DFib. Every game cannot start without a DFib. But it wasn't always the case for the W League. Mm. That was only a recent thing where the DFib has to be there with the fourth official.
And that'll become an issue when we talk to our next guest, Greg Downs. We're running out of time, Andy. Thanks for your time. Talk about John Economos and obviously your heart beat of football. We really appreciate it. Time for a break. Mm-hmm.
Are you looking to change your destiny in life, be your own boss, start your own business? If you are, you need people who understand your needs and are committed to helping you make it happen. At DKP & Co Chartered Accountants, we are more than just accountants. We are business advisors, taxation consultants, and strategists that specialized in setting up businesses. We understand the client and give them the very best customized advice and strategies to achieve their goals. Visit our website, dkpco.com.au, or give us a call today on 03 9023 9370. Fast, proactive, personal. That's DKP & Co Chartered Accountants.
Since 1998, Lanco Group has been providing superior civil engineering solutions and advice to developers, local government, and service authorities across Australia. Lanco Group is known for delivering sustainable, efficient solutions. By working closely with clients, Lanco Group is able to meet the complex infrastructure requirements for residential, commercial, and industrial developments on time, on budget. Find out more at lancogroup.com.au. Lanco Group, your business partner for engineering solutions.
Buying your electricity from the big energy companies is now the most expensive way to power your home. In fact, the average electricity bill in Australia has more than doubled in the last 15 years, but not for the ones who went solar. Unlike your electricity bill, the price of solar has actually come down, and there's also government rebates available. So what are you waiting for? Join the 2 million households already saving hundreds of dollars every year. See how much your roof could be making you at solarpowerco.com.au. Go solar and get $500 cash back with the Solar Power Co, Australia's most trusted solar brand. solarpowerco.com.au.
Welcome back to If You Know Your History on FNR for Film Nation Radio. My name is Paul Mavroudis, and with me is scholar par excellence, Greg Downs. Greg, how are you?
Hello, Paul. Nice. I'm very well, thanks. Nice to see you again. It's been a little while. Of course, you're in lockdown, but I haven't been to Melbourne now for a little bit. But yeah, nice to see you. You're looking well.
Oh, it's the light makes my hair look really nice, you see.
Very nice, yeah. It's a new style, I see.
Because I can't get a haircut. It's a nightmare. I should note all my conflicts of interest here. We're here to talk to Greg about his new book, Dedicated Lives, Stories of Pioneers of Women's Football in Australia, which is out through Fair Play Publishing. But my conflict of interest, let's just get it out of the way. I know Greg for some years now because we had, at one point, the same PhD supervisor, one Ian Sison. We both had to go through the process during a thesis where at the end of it, you have to go, thank you, Ian Sison, for your support and your mentorship.
Yes.
And obviously, also, I quoted Greg's thesis in my own thesis as well, because I did chapters on women's football. So that came in handy. Thanks a lot, Greg.
Okay. And we did work together at Victoria University for a while.
Yes, we did. Not in the exact same department, thank goodness,
no.
But we had coffees and teas at the same places.
Correct. Yeah.
We all worshipped at the altar of Ian Sison's little fiefdom, as it was then.
Yes, that's right.
He used to get upset with that as well, and that's
for better or worse. That's right.
So this book of yours is based on your PhD thesis. It's obviously a cut down version. Pretty much all the theory's gone out of it. We can talk about the theory a little bit later. But it's essentially the interviews themselves and the profiles themselves of 18 of your interview subjects.
Correct. I took them because the thesis was just used parts of the individual interviews we used to support various themes that emerged from the research. But in this book, the whole interview goes into that. So the women's stories are reproduced in full, but hopefully I tried to put it in a chronological order. So starting with Elaine and working its way through to the 2000s from the 1970s.
I mean, when I read the thesis a long time ago now, I mean, obviously the thing that always gets you in an oral history is the interviews. I mean, yes, the theory is there and it's important, but it's the stories themselves. So I remember reading many years ago, and I've still got it on my shelf, Elizabeth Kubler-Ross's, Death and Dying, the famous book where the five stages of grief emerges from.
Yep.
And look, there's a lot of theory in there, but I keep going back to the interviews, to the actual stories that the patients, the subjects are talking about.
Yeah.
It's great that the fuller interviews have managed to get through to a new publication, but also it's worthwhile for me because I've already got the thesis. So, it's worth me spending the 30 odd bucks to get a new copy of this book. But it covers a lot of things. It really is a tapestry of, say, 40 odd years of women's soccer in Australia and the various motivations, pathways, obstacles, how people get into the game. What surprised you the most about all the different stories that you heard I mean, in general, about the sort of...
I was surprised. I think when I started, I was probably very naive in terms of, you know, the depth of the history, because there was very, very little done, or very, very, very little about or written about the women's game. And I think I was surprised about how complex and deep some of the stories, or how much was involved and how much they actually dedicated, dedicated lives, how much they dedicated their lives to develop the game. And I think the thing that came out of a lot of it was they were just so keen for acknowledgement for the people that put that time and effort in, and then dedicated their lives and sometimes their whole families to the development of the game, never had any recognition, never had any respect. And I think just having someone come along and give them that opportunity they were very, very, and they're still to this date. I mean, what is it now? I think I started talking to them in 2011, and we're now, 10 years later, nearly 12 years, and I still talk to them, not all of them, but, some of them, they still are very happy about the process and having their stories and the pioneers, be acknowledged.
Those support structures are really interesting. I mean, obviously, then the first question becomes, how did you become involved in the game to the participants themselves? And obviously, in your story, you bring up the fact that your daughter started playing, and that's how you got involved.
Yeah.
And that's certainly for a lot of the family members who are involved in this. Yes, there's some who are involved, their fathers or husbands or brothers or whatever the football players. But just as often, it's just like, well, the women or the girls themselves started playing and then sort of dragged people along with them for the ride.
Yeah, well, a lot of brothers, well, even if, and this woman's not in the book, but hopefully in there, so Pat O'Connor, who is very, sadly, her husband's only recently passed, but she's started a lot of the football in New South Wales when she came here in 1963. But she started playing, she come from England, but when she started playing, she played because her husband was playing. And a lot of the others started playing because their brothers were playing. And they were dragged along to the games or the training, and they said, well, if he can play, why I want to play, family was very important in why a lot of them started to actually put their boots on.
And it's interesting as well. I mean, in the sense that when you go across the different states, from Queensland to Northern New South Wales to Sydney to Melbourne, it doesn't all line up. I mean, it seems to be a bit easier in some places to get started as a girl soccer player than it did, say, in Melbourne, for instance. Because at least the soccer infrastructure, the way it was not necessarily ethnically aligned. You didn't have those issues. It was regional, so, sporty girls were kind of accepted. It just seems a little bit easier for some people in some places.
Oh, I'd say so. I think in the bigger cities, I think once... like for Melbourne and Sydney, and particularly I think a lot of the women that I interviewed, I suppose, were more Victorian centric or Melbourne centric. And once the women started, and once the actual game started to grow, that's right, they had that infrastructure, although they were trying to move in onto the games or the grounds that were controlled by the men or the men's clubs and stuff like that. But I mean, that's right, the infrastructure was there, the numbers were there. So that it grew quickly. Like if you look at Northern New South Wales, and when they started, they had four teams, but they had to go, the area is a lot smaller and a lot faster, and the numbers just aren't there. So it's a bit slower,
I mean, this one of the things that when I first read the thesis, and it certainly comes through in the book as well, is it reveals a community of Britishness, of Englishness.
Yes. That's right. Yes, very much so.
We talk a lot about, in Australian soccer history, about obviously the post-war continental European ethnic boom and the influence that has. In more recent times, I suppose, the work that people like Andu and Roy have done, and all sorts of Australian soccer historians, focused on the very Scottish and English character of, pre-1945 soccer in Australia. I mean, it is women's football, and obviously the gender element is the key part to focus on. But my goodness, when I saw that, I'm like, this is incredible. This is a different ethnic dimension. Yep. And some of the some of the interview subjects are quite aware of it, that that's how it starts.
Yeah.
You know, they know about football in England, whether it's men's football or women's football, or whether it's just because it's part of the culture. They're aware of soccer. And it makes total sense for them to get involved here because their husbands, their brothers get involved here in certain cases.
Yeah. Well, I think their families are more so when they come here for various reasons, for work or whatever, their parents are and hook up with clubs very much, you know, straight away, communities, similar communities. But if you go through, I mean, that's right, you're right. There's a lot of them now linked to England or to Great Britain, have, you know, fathers have played in Scotland or have brothers have played or have no relatives have played or have played themselves, like Betty Hall played for Luton Ladies and then come over here. And, of course, people find out about that and, of course, contacted her. And I hear you played soccer in England, Betty. Can you help us get a team going here?
And I love that story that Betty has where she's talking about, you know, some game that they played and there was some incident in England and it gets reported in the Herald here, in Herald Sun.
Yeah, that's right.
It doesn't make any sense.
That's right. I think even Roy, I think in one of his historical publications stated that a lot of the women or a lot of people were reading about some of the escapades of women's teams in England or Great Britain during the war. And I suppose that had some kind of, you know, they were seeing the women do well and participating in a sport which wasn't normally.
Well, certainly for the 1920s movement, we sort of discussed where does that impulse come from in the 1920s? And it's like, well, clearly they probably read about it.
Yeah.
Or they've heard about it from people coming back from England after the war in their nurse work or whatever.
Yeah.
But you know, again, getting into the game, we're talking about the gatekeepers and the permissions and all this kind of stuff in a moment, but there seems to be a real split between a lot of the girls who are like, who don't even consider that they shouldn't play soccer. It's just like, I want to play soccer. That's a totally legitimate thing for me to do. And then there are other interview subjects who are like, girls can play soccer? It's that question mark. It's that, aha, what we can? Well, do I want to do this?
That's right.
Yeah. We're at a stage now where it's basically become normalized. Girls can play pretty much any sport they want to.
Yeah.
It's important to get down these stories about all the different ways people came to the game in that era when there weren't fixed, established, long-running sort of networks and pathways and infrastructures.
Oh, yeah. I mean, if they didn't know, I mean, if the girls wanted to play soccer, they'd play. They play with boys' teams or some of them cut their hair a bit or they disguise themselves to go to those sort of limits to play. I mean, others, as you said, would come to the game because they found out girls' teams were being created and go, well, that's what I want to play. You know, my brother plays that. So if I can play now, I'm going to do it. But that's right. People don't realise that's why history is so important. And I think you want to talk about oral history a bit later, but the stories and the experiences of these people during this time or any kind of period is very, very important.
It's interesting because, I mean, the things you take for granted now, again, a lot of that comes down to now. And I think this is why I'd recommend the book to pretty much anybody, but especially any woman, any girl who wants to play the game now, anyone who wants to get into administration, needs to read this book just to understand how little there was in terms of infrastructure. You see multiple interview subjects taking up multiple roles at the same time. So the players and their coaches and their administrators and their fundraisers. And each step is building upon threadbare infrastructure. And everything that women have got now, and it's still not enough. They still need more. Even we're talking about Andy Paschalidis as well, but defibrillators for the W League. Why were they for the A-League first and not the W-League as well? It came through a really difficult process. And it's even within a broader context of sports development in general, in terms of infrastructures and processes and committees and governance. Yeah. when we look at, say, the history of the VFL or the New South Wales Rugby League, you know, run on a shoestring budget, basically, by comparison, and, you know, volunteer staff and whatnot, we sometimes struggle to imagine comparing it to now, where those organisations have hundreds of staff and billions of dollars at their disposal. But yet you don't actually have to look very far to see the example of how a governance structure, an infrastructure process develops, because it's right there in front of you. It's women's sport.
I mean, some of those, well, a fair majority of those women, particularly the ones that had been in the game since, you know, the 1960s right through, and some of those now are quite elderly, but they covered those, you know, as you say, player, administrator, coach, referees,
yeah,
volunteers. I mean, the volunteer brigade, or that level that supported and made that sport grow, was phenomenal. If you take Elaine Watson, Betty Hoare, those, the clubs that they played for, the clubs that they supported, you know, the fundraising they did for buildings, dressing rooms, playing fields, it just goes on and on. And I mean, without those people and without those struggles, you know, they wouldn't be where they are today.
And because of, I mean, it's quite clear as well in the selection in this book as well, where a lot of the people are very aware of the history and the struggle. And one of the concerns that they have, and it's repeated a number of times across a few people, is once they make the mergers with, they get amalgamated into the men's mainstream system, is not just will they get treated like second-class citizens or even third-class citizens behind not just the men but the boys, but will it all be just treated as, well, we're here now and that's it, it's done, it's all accomplished? And what you lose then is the history of that struggle, the knowledge of the struggle. And certainly in the case of the Victorian response, like Maggie Cumey, very aware that they had to retain the knowledge and the history of what had come before. Because if they didn't have that knowledge, if they lost it, then everything that they fought for was always at risk of going back to what it was.
I think Teresa Dias in the book says it really well, that she was concerned that if and when the Australian Women's Association amalgamated with the men's game, that they didn't see it as, okay, we've just started now. We didn't start the game in 2000.
Mm.
This game has been played for decades before that, and that history, they were worried that that history would be lost. And I think that was one of the main struggles that they had to deal with. If we go this way, does that mean, you know, we don't want the game, the women's game, to just be seen, okay, we're with the men's now and this is where we start. We don't want to dis and lose that history. And the pioneers that put in all that work to get them where they were at that point. I mean, there were reasons why they probably were. It was a fait accompli, and they had to amalgamate with the men if they wanted to sort of play internationally as well under FIFA. Mm. But that's a very real reason. And they were very, very concerned about that.
And it's, you, when you don't have the depth as well. So, I mean, a lot of those early days, you know, you have 12-year-olds playing with 30-year-olds.
Yeah.
And
I don't know how they did that.
Well, I think I can't remember who it was, but somebody was talking about being, I think it was maybe Teresa Davis, I can't remember, but, you know, talking about being goalkeeper and getting flipped in the air within about 5 minutes.
Yeah.
But it's, do you wonder sometimes when you were doing these interviews, whether if other mainstream sports like Australian rules or rugby league were available to these people, would they have taken those sports up? Was soccer just a convenient option in some cases because it didn't have an entrenched kind of, as much an entrenched opposition to women playing?
That's a good point. That's a good question. I gave it much thought really, but I think that soccer probably would have been a little bit more available to them. I mean, it would have been a more amenable, mainly because of family connections and stuff, I think. I think the the opportunities for them to play, say, rugby league or AFL probably wouldn't have been there. It would have been a greater barrier for sure.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, it's quite a few times they want to talk about the physicality of playing. Yeah. They enjoy that the way you can express yourself playing soccer. You can't say in netball or in hockey in the same kind of way, even though hockey is a very similar sport logistically, conceptually. That certainly comes up a lot. I want to express myself physically in this way.
Yeah.
Sorry,
they like to play the game hard as well. They like to play it. They like
I've seen it firsthand. Yeah. I've seen it at the lowest levels. It's one of the things that comes up that's really interesting, and it's a sort of a minor thread, but it does run through. I mean, yeah, they talk a lot about the sacrifices they make to play internationally and state teams and to do tours and whatever. And there's also the players that sort of rebelled against that as well a little bit. They didn't like how serious it had gotten.
No.
And that's a really interesting, because sometimes you look at women's football and say, are they trying to be too much like the men? How does it maintain its own cultural particularities? The netballer Liz Ellis asked this question about the professionalisation of women's sport in general a few years ago. It was a really interesting question. How do we avoid making women's sport exactly like men's sport with all the vices and the aggressiveness and the sort of lack of camaraderie involved in that? Where you see even like social level male soccer players are hyper-competitive.
Yeah.
You get aggro.
I think professional sport brings that anyway, Paul.
Sure. But even very low levels of men's soccer have that quality.
Yeah.
And it's interesting when you watch, there's a Victorian videographer, Stephen Gray, who has a series called Football Chaos, where he films games from all sorts of aspects from Victorian soccer every weekend. Yeah. And one of the great things that he does is he films very low level women's soccer. Sometimes even the churches leave.
Yeah.
And it's purely social.
Yeah.
And what you notice, and it's what I noticed when I first started watching women's soccer maybe 15 years ago, when I was watching a friend of mine play, how much they just love it. They just love it.
Yeah.
It's the game. It's the friendships.
Yeah.
It's the social
aspect. Definitely. There's that love and that social aspect of the game. And I think they just want to play. And I suppose if you're talking about that upper elite level of professional sport, if you're talking Matildas and the women and the girls that are trying to get in and break into that, of course there's that hard line aspect.
But the more players that women's soccer gets, the further down that professional aspect comes.
That's right.
And it's an interesting challenge for what women's soccer is, especially for people that have grown up with it a certain way. You know, who they talk about the friends and the relationships and the camaraderie and the fun.
Yeah.
It's a very different thing now because the top is coming closer in a lot of ways. So, you know, you've got NPL players who are starting to get a little bit of money for what they're doing. They're being treated with professional coaches and so forth.
Yeah.
And it leads on into the other aspect as well, where, you know, people want to continue coaching, but if you're a woman, you can't coach men's teams because that's pretty much most men's teams are not even going to get close to considering that. And yet the cost of becoming a women's coach is the same as becoming a men's coach, but there isn't the same money for coaching women's teams.
Mm.
So it's interesting to see all the different motivations and sort of colliding against each other.
Yeah.
And it's going to be interesting to see this as a sort of a footnote, as a touchstone. This is where we were at a particular point in time. And sort of to measure that against, we need those kind of milestones. And that's a really good thing, because obviously we have Elaine Watson's books and there's more women's soccer books coming out and all this. But this is a really key one because it captures 40 years of very different kinds of struggles. And Heather Reid's book as well, with Marion Stell, it's a similar kind of thing.
Yeah.
From a different angle, from the very top echelon, because she covered exclusively the Matildas journey in that drew that era. But it's a fascinating book. It's dedicated lives, stories of pioneers of women's football in Australia. It's by Greg Downs, by Fair Pay Publishing. It's about $30-odd. Well worth it. It's very
$29. I think it's $29.95, mate. Cheap at half the price.
Yes.
Thanks for the kind words, Paul.
We're going to take a quick break, and then we'll be back with Greg again. We'll talk about a little bit about oral histories and the methodology behind writing a book like this. This is If You Know Your History on FNR Football Nation Radio.
Are you looking to change your destiny in life? Be your own boss?
Have you done it?
Start your own business? If you are, you need people who understand your needs and are committed to helping you make it happen. At DKP & Co Chartered Accountants, we are more than just accountants. We are business advisors, taxation consultants, and strategists that specialised in setting up businesses. We understand the client and give them the very best customised advice and strategies to achieve their goals. Visit our website, dkpco.com.au, or give us a call today on 03 9023 9370. Fast, proactive, personal. That's DKP & Co Chartered Accountants.
Since 1998, Lanco Group has been providing superior civil engineering solutions and advice to developers, local government and service authorities across Australia. Lanco Group is known for delivering sustainable, efficient solutions. By working closely with clients, Lanco Group is able to meet the complex infrastructure requirements for residential, commercial and industrial developments on time, on budget. Find out more at lancogroup.com.au. Lanco Group, your business partner for engineering solutions.
Buying your electricity from the big energy companies is now the most expensive way to power your home. In fact, the average electricity bill in Australia has more than doubled in the last 15 years, but not for the ones who went solar. Unlike your electricity bill, the price of solar has actually come down, and there's also government rebates available. So what are you waiting for? Join the 2 million households already saving hundreds of dollars every year. See how much your roof could be making you at solarpowerco.com.au. Go solar and get $500 cash back with the Solar Power Co, Australia's most trusted solar brand. solarpowerco.com.au.
Welcome back to If You Know Your History on FNR Football Nation Radio, streaming on Facebook, Twitch and Twitter. With us is Greg Downs. We were just talking before the previous segment about his new book, Dedicated Lives, Stories of Pioneers of Women's Football in Australia. It's an oral history and, well, I thought it'd be useful just to have a little bit of a chat about the process of doing oral history. Especially in an academic context, because I don't think a lot of our listeners who do histories would have ever done that aspect of it before. Before you started your PhD thesis, Greg, did you have any experience at all with oral history and its practice, its theory?
Nil. I was very, very naive in terms of the oral history process. I thought I get on quite well with people. I like talking to people, I like listening to people, and I think my personality lends itself to that kind of practice. But once you start and get into the academic side of things, particularly, there's a lot to it. And I think the main part, particularly from the beginning, it's the ethical practice that particularly the university requires you to go through. And there's an ethics approval process that you need to undertake, and that's just in the beginning. And of course, then when you go into the actual process and engaging with your participants or interviewees, you need to be very mindful of the individual that you're talking to and what you want to get out of the conversation, what questions you got to ask, and so forth and so on.
I would just explain to our listeners that when you do a PhD thesis, at least at Victoria University as it was then, you have to do at least a couple of compulsory units of study. One is about research methodologies and how to write a thesis. And the other one was about ethical considerations across a range of issues. And I would sit in these classes and I was doing a literature thesis, and meanwhile I had people doing biomechanical and bioethical, theses, scientific theses, social work theses, and I'm sitting there like, Yeah, this is no good to me. I mean, I can learn something by osmosis, I suppose. But, I mean, I was fortunate in the sense I didn't have to do the ethical process because, really, I was just looking at books mostly. But I was... There would be times when, you know, you're sitting up in upstairs in one of the PhD doctorate rooms where people, you know, got their own space, the computers, and you'd see some of these students going, oh, I've gotten right back from an ethics committee again, or they didn't understand this, why would they let me do that? And you just try to be sympathetic and say, well, you know, it's sometimes they don't trust the interview subjects enough. These are people dealing with like refugees and so forth, and like very vulnerable people. So at what point did you think this is going to be a lot harder than you thought it was going to be?
When I started to write the, the ethic, I think I had to put my ethics application in a couple of times. I never went to an ethics class. I didn't know they had them.
Oh.
So I was lucky there. But I think once I started to, when you have to choose your methodology and then you have to go through the process of explaining why you chose it and the benefits for it, what was involved in it, and the ups and downs and the pros and cons of doing that methodology. Because a lot of people, academics would argue that the oral history process or methodology is not solid. And there are a lot of people that argue against it based on the validity, you know, the credibility of people's memory, for example. Was it, is that true history? It's only people's memory of that incident or whatever, the past, and what kind of bias that would bring to that. And then you have to look at yourself as the interviewer. I'm a male, middle-aged, I think I was mid-50s then. I was a white male, and I was talking to women about women's sport. Was that appropriate? And then some people would say no. Because I would be a bias, I'd be pushing my agenda instead of letting them tell their stories. And there's all those kind of those issues floating around: bias, memory, credibility. I'd say you've got to get your grip, you've got to get your head around that, and then you've got to prove to the reader or the examiner that what you were going to do was going to usurp all those issues.
So obviously the first step is to actually get the trust of the ethics committee.
That's correct.
And then you've got to get the trust of the interview subjects, the participants, to use the correct terminology.
Yeah.
How do you get the trust of participants in that situation?
Well, I suppose there's a degree. I just went in very, very open, and I told them we had a participant's approval and agreement form which they would read, and I would explain that to them, that this is the process that I would be going through, that if they had any problem, they didn't want to continue it, they didn't have to, and I would let them have a look at the questions beforehand so they knew if there was anything that they wanted to ask. It was, and I just asked the questions and trusted that they would tell me their story. So that's all I basically wanted to hear. I wasn't trying to throw any trick questions in there. I just wanted to let them tell their story, basically. And
I mean some of the people you spoke to were clearly well educated, were from, had academic backgrounds themselves, so some of them understood the process. They were accomplished in their own right in terms of high achieving fields. But quite a few of the people you're talking to, they're like, I dropped out of school at such and such an age. Well, they come from very working class backgrounds. So the way that different groups sort of approach an academic person is quite different, isn't it?
Yeah. I never had any of those kind of problems that differ. Of course, they speak to you differently and they express themselves differently. What I did notice sometimes, though, that once the transcript of the interview went back to the interviewees and they would read it, and once they knew it was to be published, some of them would go, oh, I don't want that part in it. Well, they don't want, you know, they'd be a little bit more retrospect on actually what they were actually saying. And if they knew the whole interview was being sort of published, they were a little bit worried about some of the issues that were raised. And so
were there particular issues that were raised that across the board that were sort of like people were afraid to speak up about? Or
well they might have mentioned it to me in the interview while we were chatting away, but they might be have mentioned somebody's name about something that had happened, and they thought, oh, maybe I shouldn't, I don't want that to be said because I don't want their friends or they I know them, or I don't want people to get the wrong idea about what I'm trying to say and stuff like that.
It's very interesting because obviously the issue du jour of women's soccer the last week is abuse and harassment and sexuality.
Yeah.
And obviously the sexuality is something that come up in this, and I understand people will be uncomfortable speaking a lot about a lot of those things for a lot of reasons. And but one of the most common thread is how much of a positive spin people try to put on their time in the game. And I wonder if there's any if you felt there was any sort of sense of they were trying to put too much of a positive spin or trying to sort of negate some of the negatives that they were experienced.
I think they're all really, really honest. There were I didn't, in terms of the sexuality, from my position, I didn't want to go in directly about the sexuality issue. Mm. I asked open questions, and some of the women went there, and some didn't. But I didn't press that. I didn't think back then that I was in a position where I was going to make sort of judgment calls or comments based on women's sexuality. So I sort of left that a little bit, you know, alone. Mm. But if they wanted to make a comment, and some did, you know, and was very open, I don't think anyone. I mean, there were some changes at the back end because they were a little bit concerned about some comments, but I think the majority were very, very honest, and that I think that come through very clearly.
It's an interesting question because, I mean, one of the things I've sort of written down as a note is, I mean, when you're doing the interviews and then you're writing it down and transcribing it, you want to get across the natural voice of the participant, and I think you do that pretty well here. Like, I know Maggie Cumey. One of the interview subjects is Maggie Cumey, a stalwart of Victorian soccer.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've known her for about a decade now, I think. Yeah. When I read that bit, I'm like, yeah, that's Maggie.
Yeah.
The vocabulary.
I didn't change it.
Yeah.
And I didn't change the interviews. I wanted to leave them. And a lot of them had some kind of, you know, they'd repeat themselves a little bit. I didn't want to go back and really tidy them up to a degree, if you know what I mean, and want of a better term. But yeah, I think that brings their character through a little bit.
How reliable are memories? What did you find out about memory when you completed this process?
That's a good question. I asked there was an author I went to have a chat. I went to one of his promotions of his book, an Australian author, and William McInnes. Do you know William McInnes?
Yeah, he came to my house once to do a filming for Blue Heelers.
Okay. Well, he was promoting one of his books up in Byron, and I went to it was a drinks and nibblies function. And Gail was, we were sitting there and I was thinking about writing a history of my mother at the time. And my brothers always had a go at me because they reckon my memory's shot. All of my stories were not true. So we asked him the question, what happens when you write stories about based on your memory of your family and your brothers or sisters disagreed? He goes, that's my memory. That's all important. That's what I write based on what I remember. So I took a lot out of that, and I thought that was very, very important. I didn't learn anything new about memory per se, but I think I based my belief on their honesty and what they told me. And I think you can tell when you talk to people, although they were just so pleased and so happy to be able to share this story, that someone was actually taking them seriously, that I had no problem with believing them.
It's an interesting case study in the case of, say, women's soccer in general, but especially in Victoria, I mean, there's so little documentation which survives a women's psycho across the board for all sorts of reasons. So oral history is almost like default the way you have to go about writing a history of women's psycho. But you have this situation in Victoria, for instance, where the women's clubs are less clubs and more teams. So when they find the going tough at one particular men's club, they move to another club and then they move again and the name changes. And you see that come up a lot. And then there's a whole black hole of information from about 1984 to about 1992. So I know Victoria's History and Heritage Coordinator Tony Pasoglia will be fascinated with this book because it's got at least some recollection, vaguely at least, of timelines of what happened in those kind of missing 8 or 10 years. It's, but you sit there sometimes and you're like, how do you make sense of this? How do you verify a lot of this information? And I guess you have to just trust people in this kind of, in this particular instance.
I tried to track different things or different comments for that related to different clubs. And some I got onto, I have talked to say Watsonia Football Club and where Betty Hoare and Mick Horst contributed in the early days back in the 80s. And Caroline Monk played, and I think she was the only girl that come from a woman that played for the Matildas from that club. So if I can or can find links, I try and contact different places to verify things, and they've been very, very helpful. There's a lot of work. I said there's a lot of opportunities for work out there if someone wants to do it.
Last question. Most of the time, are you interviewing one-on-one?
Most of the time. I did have occasions where like a couple would turn, say Nikki Leach and Caroline Monk, say for good friends, turned up together. I didn't expect that, but it happened. And I think Therese Dias and Maggie Coomey were together.
And obviously Mick
and Betty.
I will finish up on this because actually years before you started this project, I think, you know, Ian and I actually interviewed Betty and Mick or part of a project. And it's almost like one person.
Yeah. See, they'd obviously, he'd be going, no, that's not right. And they'd be arguing they'd be about jumping.
So it's interesting because obviously obviously they share a lot of the history. They come up through it together.
Yeah.
But really the person you really want to talk to is Betty.
Yeah.
But they're kind of inseparable.
Yeah. And Betty's memory was a little bit, wasn't, what she'd constantly say, I can't remember the date, but then Mick had come in and say it was in 19 whatever. And I think in the thesis, I talk about both of them. They're interviewed separately, but in the book, I just concentrated more on Betty and wove Mick in there.
Yeah. It's a really interesting, there's a lot of different dynamics between the men and women's relationships, family relationships.
Yeah.
That's the one where it's just so intertwined.
Definitely. Well, they were married at a young age. They were married like in their late teens in London. So they've been together for, their whole ride's been football. Their whole life's been football. So that shows.
Well, Greg, I think we've come up to the end of the show. Thanks for your time.
My pleasure.
Really appreciate you getting to promote the book and hope that a few people would go out there and buy it. And thanks for having a chat a bit about oral histories as well and give us a little bit of an insight into how it works on the academic level. It's not just rocking up to someone in the street with a microphone going, tell me about your life.
That's right. I wish it was.
All right.
But thanks, mate, thank you very much for the offer. And it's really nice to see you again.
Oh, it's always good to talk to you.
Yeah. Okay, mate. Thanks right. again.
See ya. And that's the end of the episode. You've been listening to If You Know Your History on FNR Football Nation Radio, and we'll see you again next time.
Thanks, Paul.